So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and welcome to RBF 247. So guys, as you must be knowing that our today's session was it didn't happen because of some technical error. There was some network issues. That is why I told you that we are going to post a recorded video. So here is that video for day 44, right? So let's move on to question number 1, and before doing that I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to press this bell icon which is flashing on the screen, and it can help you to stay in touch with us and can provide you with access to a lot of good content which can help you to prepare for your examinations, right? So guys, here is your question number 1 for the day, and this question says dash expenses are borne directly by the individual and paid to the health service provider without any aid from the insurance company or the state. So guys, if you look at this question talks about some sort of expenses that a patient or a person, whoever falls ill, has to pay himself or herself without any help from the government or the insurance company, right? So let's move on to the answer for this question, and the correct answer is option C. And option C is out-of-pocket expenses, right? So as you can guess from its name itself, it says out-of-pocket. The expenses which directly come out of your own pocket or from patient's own pocket. So they are not being paid by government or the state. So as you must be knowing, in many countries of the world, so social the healthcare services which are provided to citizens are very good. The state incurs the cost of medical expenses, or insurance is provided to the citizens, health insurance, so that if they fall ill, they can rely on that insurance. But in India, such social security nets are not very strong. That is why in India, most of the patients have to incur such expenses out of their own pockets. That is why they are known as out of pocket. But if you have a medical insurance, like, right? So if you have a medical insurance and if you fall ill, then if you don't go to a doctor and you get hospitalized, then all the expenses are borne by the insurance company. You don't have to pay them because you are already paying the premium to the insurance company. Or many government employees, they are already provided insurance by their own employers or the organizations in which they work, right? But most of the population in India does not have access to this benefit. So here, let us learn something about the Indian healthcare system. It is already very weak. It is not one of the good network systems in the world. And this coronavirus pandemic has come as a wake-up call for an otherwise undisciplined healthcare system in India, right? So India's healthcare spending is around 3.6% of GDP. So India spends 3.6% of its GDP on developing healthcare facilities for its citizens, which is one of the lowest among the developing countries, right? So as a developing country, India has got to spend more on its healthcare system so that the citizens of India are more healthy, so that they can work efficiently and contribute to the growth and prosperity of the nation, right? So I think Scandinavian countries are very popular for providing good social security to their citizens, right? So if a person not belonging to very well economic background falls ill, that person can rely on states in such countries. But that is not the case in our country. That is why we need to spend more on the healthcare, right? Often, whatever funds are allocated, often these funds are rendered either unutilized or underutilized. So whatever funds are allocated, even they are not used properly, right? And after that, we also have corruption and problems related to bureaucracy and red tapism that do not allow projects to take shape, right? Private healthcare, on the other hand, is known for its good quality, but it's undoubtedly costly, so mostly unaffordable by most of the population or out of the reach of the poor. Here you can see government hospitals have around 7,14,000 beds, or you can say 0.6 beds per 1,000 patients, right? And especially the rural healthcare system, it is not in a very good condition. It needs attention in a very dire manner, right? So it has been suffering from shortage of medicines, instruments, as well as trained medical personnel, right? And even lack basic amenities. So here we talked about out of pocket expenses. You can see that India ranks very high on this tangent. So why are we studying this out of pocket expenses? What does it tell us? It tells us about the healthcare system prevalent in our country. So India ranks very high on this. That means most of the people have to bear all the medical expenses by their own pocket, and they cannot expect any help from the government or the insurance company. As you can see here, 62.4% is the out-of-pocket expenses in India, whereas the world average is 18.55%. So almost 3.5% of it, right? So almost 3.5 times India's ratio is of world average, right? And once a person from a poor family gets a disease whose medical expense is too much, then that person is driven to poverty. And or if a person who is already not from a very good economic background, if he gets a disease whose expense is too much or whose treatment costs too much, that person is definitely going to go bankrupt, right? So what can we do to improve this healthcare in India? So the numbers of doctors cannot go up in the short run, although government should look into it, because education is the only way, only key through which healthcare can be developed. But in the short term, paramedical workers can be trained or for doing not so important jobs like blood pressure monitoring or routine checkups. So the jobs which do not require a specialized doctor or a very trained professional, such jobs can be taken care by paramedical workers, right? Also, telemedicine should be encouraged. So medicine which is portable, or if people can be treated in bus or a moving vehicle, so such sort of mediums should be promoted, right? So guys, here I would like to add one thing. I was reading a report on cancer while I was studying for a research. There I came to know that WHO has a standard. So WHO says in a country there should be one doctor for every 1,000 persons, right? Just give me a second. Okay, one doctor for 1,000 people, right? And no state in India matches up to this standard. So the best was of Delhi. So in Delhi there is about one doctor for every 2,000 people. So guys, do remember that I'm just giving you an average. I don't remember the exact terms. I'm just telling you that where we stand on the world averages, right? So this I think this was around 2,000 people. So you can see Delhi being the best in India, still its ratio is almost double of the world average, or the average that WHO requires, right? Whereas I think the worst was in the state of Bihar, where there is one doctor for about 44,000 people, right? So you can see the system, the healthcare facilities available in India. Now moving on to the next question, and the next question says, PM Modi has asked the Civil Aviation Ministry to expedite privatization of dash more airports in a bid to make them more efficient and garner more revenues for the exchequer, right? So this question talks about, as you know, privatization of some airports. So already some have been privatized, but now PM Modi is asking for tenders for some more airports. And how many airports are those? So option E is correct. That means 6 airports. 6 airports are going to be privatized soon. 6 more airports. So earlier also 6 airports were privatized. So here you can see that PM Modi is inviting tendering process in coming 3 months for these airports, so that these airports, the maintenance and the taking care of these airports can become more efficient. The aviation sector could turn into a more efficient sector, right? This would be done in cooperation with the armed forces and help the public and airlines save costs. So obviously, if the airports are going to be more efficient and they are working on more efficiently with less inputs, obviously they are going to save costs. And if they are going to save costs, that benefit is going to be transferred to the public. So this is an ambitious privatization plan. The right to manage airports would be granted for 50 years under these projects on a revenue sharing model. The statement did not specify the 6 airports that would be privatized, but the state-run Airport Authority of India has already recommended the public-private partnership. So we have already studied what is public-private partnership in one of our previous sessions. So it is a model where the public sector or the government and the private sector, they work hand in hand to complete a project or to run an organization, right? So this would work on a PPP model. So this model has been recommended for airports at Amritsar, Varanasi, Bhubaneswar, Indore, Raipur and Tiruchirappalli, right? So these are the 6 airports. So guys, do remember that this proposal was put in last year. Now the tendering processes have started to begin or PM Modi has asked for it, right? So the government is all set to make the functioning of the Office of Director General of Civil Aviation to reduce processing time of various licenses and permissions. That means licenses and permissions for such projects should be given at a faster rate so that these processes could be done in a rapid manner. And the government plans to privatize 30 to 35 more airports in phases of next 5 years, right? So I hope we are clear with these two questions. Now moving on to the third question for this lecture. And the third question says here, it asks you to select some correct statements out of 5 statements, right? So as you can see, there are 2 statements mentioned in every option. That means there are 2 statements that are correct out of these 5 statements, right? So let's see what the correct answer is. The correct answer is option E. That means option 3 and 4, statements 3 and 4 are correct, whereas the rest of them 1, 2 and 5 are incorrect. So let's read the correct statements. They say companies are required to deposit 24% of the basic and HRA deductions as EPF contribution, 12% as the employer's share and 12% as the employee's share. So here every company or every employer, so there is also a threshold that the companies have to fulfill that makes them come under the ambit of this law. So these companies which fulfill this threshold, they have to deposit some money as EPF or Employee Provident Fund contribution. So guys, as you remember, in first question we were talking about the social security nets or the benefits that government provides to the citizens of a country. So EPF and such benefits are part of these social security programs which are run in order to make the citizens more prepared or in order to provide some financial backing to the citizen in case of any emergency or at least saving for their retirement, right? So as a contribution to employee provident fund, an employer or companies have to deposit 24% of the employees basic and HRA deductions as EPF contribution. So the total of basic plus HRA deduction, they have to, 24% of this amount has to be deposited as contribution to EPF. 12% is the employer shares that the employer pays from his or her own pocket, whereas 12% comes from the employee's salary. So this 12% is cut from the employee's income, whereas the other 12% is contributed by the employer, right? So the total 24% goes into this EPF contribution. After that, such is the ESCI rules. Under this, industries have to deposit 4% of workers' salaries, 3.25% employer share and 0.75% employees' share as a statutory deduction to meet the healthcare needs of the industrial workers, right? So ESCI, they are for the healthcare needs of industrial workers, whereas EPF EPF is usually meant for saving for retirement or for any contingencies that require money that employees can use later in their life, right? So these are the two contributions that the employers have to make, right? So as you can see, currently the union government said that it has pushed back the deadline for depositing monthly statutory provident fund and employee health insurance deductions of millions of formal sector employees till 15th June, which gives thousands of companies a liquidity boost of a total of around 15,000 crore. So these deposits, they have to be made monthly, right? But currently, looking at the situations, government has decided that we should give a 30-day extension to the companies if they are not able to deposit these contributions, right? So the contribution for March, which has to be deposited by 15th April, after 30-day extension, it can be deposited till 15th May, and the contribution for April, which has to be deposited till 15th May, can be deposited till 15th June, right? So a 30-day extension has been provided by government, and now since companies have 30 more days to fulfill these contributions to deposit this money, they have a better access to liquidity. They can use their funds for one more month, or they have one more month to arrange these funds, right? So this gives a liquidity boost of around 15,000 crore to the companies, right? So I hope the aim is clear, that why is the government doing this? To provide liquidity to the companies who are not able to make to fulfill such contributions, right? So now moving on to the question number 4 for the day. So guys, before moving to question number 4, I would like to ask you to join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries, and we'll try to get back to you as soon as possible, right? So here is your question number 4 for the day. Dash is the right to retain goods or securities belonging to a debtor until dues are paid fully to the retainer of the goods, whereas the essence of dash is that the goods must be delivered to the possession of the lender, right? So here you can see this question talks about some concepts, and you have to choose the correct option out of the 5 options given below, right? So the correct option for this question is option C, that means lien and pledge. So lien is the right to retain goods. Just give me So lien is the right to retain goods or securities belonging to a debtor until dues are paid fully to the retainer, whereas the essence of pledge is that the goods must be delivered to the possession of the lender. So guys, these are two contracts, or you can say these are two situations where goods of one party are kept with the goods with the another party, right? But what is the difference between them? So here we have to understand about the difference between lien and pledge. In both of the cases, the goods of a debtor. So let's say there are two parties. There is a creditor who has lent money to a debtor, and this debtor as a collateral pays the goods to creditor. So this debtor, as he wants to avail some funding from the creditor, he pays some goods as collateral to this creditor, then it would be known as a pledge, right? And these goods which the creditor has taken as collateral will be in possession of the creditor, right? But now what happens in the case of lien? In lien also, the goods of debtor are kept with the creditor. But what the difference is, lien is not a contract in itself. Lien is a right that comes under a superior contract, right? So let's say there was a trade deal between two parties, Mr. A and Mr. B, right? So Mr. A bought some goods from Mr. B and didn't make any payment for that, right? So now A has to pay back to B, right? So A bought some goods from B and B has to deliver goods to A, whereas A has to pay to B. Now what can happen, let's say if when the due date for the deal comes, if A does not pay any money to B, B can stop the goods or B can retain the goods. B will not deliver any goods to Mr. A as the payment of B has not been made. So B will say that A, Mr. A, give me the money which I deserve and take your goods. But until you pay your dues, I'm not going to give you the goods. So here there was another contract between them. There was a contract of a trade deal with under which the right of lien comes with B, right? So A and B didn't actually do any contract. They didn't do any contract of lien, but this lien was implied or underlying in any other, in another contract, right? So lien is just a right, whereas pledge is a contract in itself, right? Pledge is entered with the consent of the parties. So guys, I hope now the difference between lien and pledge is clear to you. Here we can see some more differences among them. So lien is a type of bailment in which one party keeps the goods of another parties till the dues are paid, right? Right to retain the goods or securities belonging to a debtor until the dues are fully paid to the creditor, right? No special agreement is necessary for creating the right of lien. So as I told you, no special contract for lien, but general liens are created by special agreements. So if there is an agreement between two parties, general lien is created because of that agreement, but there is no another contract necessary for the right of lien, right? So it is you can assume that it is implied in another contract, right? Banks granting a loan against marking the lien on customer's deposit with them is an example of general lien. That if the bank is giving a loan to a person or to a party and that party has some deposits with that bank can have a right of lien on those deposits until the loan is paid back to the bank, right? So lien is created by law or by express or implied contract. And usually in case of a lien, the party holding the goods or retaining the goods cannot sell those goods unless and until the contract mentions so. There is a contract and it says in case of any default of payment, the creditor would be able to sell the goods until the contract mentions some sort of this thing. Till then, the right of lien does not allows selling of goods, right? But in case of pledge, goods are deposited as a security for payment of the debt, where party has taken the debt and goods are pledged as a collateral, right? So there should be a contract to return the same goods which were pledged after the debt is repaid, right? So the pledgee or the pawnee has the right to retain the goods not only for the debt or performance of the promise. He can retain the goods pledged to him for all the necessary expenses incurred to him in respect of preservation of the goods pledged, right? And it also gives the creditor the right to sell on default. So what does this point says? This point says that if there is a creditor who has some goods pledged with him in respect of an unpaid payment, then if that person holding or retaining the goods have to spend some money on the upkeep of those particular goods or that particular product, then that person is also that person has right to recover that money from the person who is actually the owner of the goods or who has actually pledged the goods with the pledgee, right? So if there are two parties A and B, and Mr. A, let's say, has taken a loan from Mr. B, so A has taken the loan from Mr. B and pledged his car as a collateral. In that case, if A does not pay back the loan of Mr. B, the B can sell the car to recover his payment. And if B has to spend some money on this car to sell it or to maintain it, let's say B has to get the car serviced or has to spend some money on the maintenance of the car, then B is also liable to recover this money, the money spent on the upkeep of this car from A, right? Pledge is created by contract between the parties, right? When two parties, they actually have a contract of pledge, where one takes loan and pledges the goods, right? Whereas lien is a part of some superior contract. Now, I hope we are clear with the difference between lien and pledge. Now, moving on to the last question for today, and this question says, dash is used for creating charge against immovable property, whereas dash is used for creating charge against the security of movable assets, right? So this is a similar question. So guys, this question was, I think, asked by Saurabh Tiwari in the comments, and I hope he is watching it, and his doubts are cleared regarding all the concepts discussed here. So the answer for this question is option B, that is mortgage and hypothecation. So mortgage, the term mortgage is used when a charge is creating against an immovable property, and the word hypothecation is used when a charge is created against movable assets. So right, guys, mortgage and hypothecation, they are very similar to each other, that an asset is bought by taking a loan, and if that asset or a loan is taken by putting some asset as a collateral or a property as a collateral, then if the property is immovable in nature, then it is called mortgage. And if there is a movable asset, right, like car or scooter, then it is called hypothecation. So let's take some examples to understand this. So if you buy a land, or you buy a house, or you buy a building, and you take a loan for buying these properties, so as you can see, these are immovable properties, then that would be known as mortgage. And if you buy a car or you buy a scooter and you take a loan against them, then in that case, that would be called hypothecation, right? So as you know, if you will not pay the loan or the installments of your car, which is bought on an EMI, then the bank is liable to take the car away and sell it to recover its dues. Same goes for a building. If you do not pay the EMIs, if you do not pay the interest payments or the principal payments, then the bank providing you the mortgage is liable to sell, has a right to sell this building to recover the payments, right? So these are similar terms, just there is difference in the nature of the asset, right? And now if we compare it with pledge, so under pledge, a loan is taken and goods are put for collateral. In these cases also, a loan is taken against the assets bought. So guys, do understand, in these cases, mortgage and hypothecation, the loan is taken against an asset bought, whereas in pledge, some sort of goods are kept as collateral for taking the loan. Also, in case of pledge, the goods which are put as collateral have to be deposited to the possession of the creditor, right? As we saw in the case of A and B here. So if A took a loan from B, he deposited his car as a collateral, or he pledged his car as a collateral by giving it or placing that car with Mr. B. But in case of hypothecation and mortgage, the goods are still in the possession of the debtor or the borrower. So if you buy a car or take it on EMI, you don't have to keep the car with the bank unless you pay all the dues. You can use the car, but if you will not fulfill the payments, then the bank has right to take the car and sell it. Same goes for all the assets against which mortgage is taken, right? So guys, I hope we are clear between among these terms: mortgage, hypothecation, pledge, lien. And there is one more term present here, which is known as assignment. Assignment means transfer of a contract, right? So I hope we are clear among these terms. And here you can see some more description which is given regarding hypothecation, mortgage, and hypothecation and pledge, right? So I think we have already discussed these points. And so guys, these were the 5 questions for the day, and I hope you watched this video and got to learn something new from this video. And if you did, don't forget to hit the like button, and we'll meet on Monday with some new set of questions and try to learn some more concepts which affect the economy or have some implications in the finance world, right? So thank you for watching this video, and see you all on Monday.